started the interview with is a little bit of a background on your own personal involvement with the boer goats, because I understand that not only with boer goats but with Dorper sheep, you've got quite an extensive background and history with some of the South African small stock breeds.
Yeah, Brian. I started off as an extension officer in Namibia, Southwest Africa, and there we did a lot of cattle work, but also to some extent with small stock. And then when I later came to South Africa, I did the research work on cattle, but also on small stock. And eventually, I got more involved in small stock, and I did a lot of field research on small stock, also for my doctor. And the result is, some of my colleagues had worked with these flies, Drosophila melagaster. They got their doctorates in 2 years. I worked about 12 or 14 years because I was working with animals that if, you can't breed them so quickly. But it, I enjoyed the work, and I always try to work on practical problems. And one of the first things I identified is that adaptability. You can have the best animals in the world, the nicest looking animals, but if they can't survive, then there's only one way, and that is you'll have to go on your knees before your bank manager, and then he's anyway going to clean you out. So adaptability, the ability to survive, that is number one. And not to only survive, but to reproduce. So I looked a lot at that, reproduction.
Because in type between savannah goats and boer goats, in particular some of the criticisms that have been leveled against the savannah in terms of their slab sides and tendency to be a little hawky. What would be your comment in that area?
I think the criticism is valid when you look at it, but my biggest objection is that we found out that when you in external conditions of Southern Africa, if you get your animal, it can be a goat, it can be sheep, it can be cattle, if you get them with two rounded ribs, the ribs are too rounded, they are too wide, they heavily muscled, then you pay and if you lose something, and that is the adaptability of the animal, the ability to survive under animals that came down, they survived under extremely unfavorable conditions, and they developed it through natural selection and through selecting by the predators. Look, those animals that survived, they escaped the predators. They could run faster, they could look after their kids and their lambs better. So they developed a certain conformation. And if we go too far away from that conformation that nature has selected in goats, sheep, cat, whatever, in South Africa and Southern Africa, then we're putting at risk that hardiness, that ability to survive under unfavorable conditions, the ability to convert low-quality roughage into high-quality nutritional red meat. And so you're not getting such an impressive animal if you look at these traits, but you're getting a functionally more efficient animal with those trays. Because, remember, always Brian, in Africa, there are three supreme masters, and that is sunlight, water, and heat, and ultraviolet conditions. They are the supreme masters, and they select animals and plants, because things, any living organism that can't stand the high rainfall sometimes, but also very low rainfall, the high temperatures and the low temperatures and the extreme sunlight conditions in Southern Africa, those organisms are going to die, whether it's a goat or grass or whatever. Mm-hmm. So we've got to work with those masters, and we've got to select with nature and not against them. And when you select with nature, then you're going to get something a bit different is than you're going to get when you say we're going to select under these conditions. Then you change the environmental conditions, and then you can select and you can get those big, wide, long-bodied animals with all that heavy muscular ability. But then you've got to have protection. You've got to put up sheds. You can put them in when it suddenly gets cold, when it gets too warm. You've got to provide additional feeding when it's the quality of the grazing goes down. So you've got to see and decide how far can you go. And personally, I think one should not deviate too much from what nature has selected.
Has that been the basis to the standards that have been developed for the savannah goats?
Brian, that's correct. That is the basic traits that we looked at when we decided to draw up the standards of the savannah goats. We didn't sit in a room and around the table and develop the breed standards. We went out into the field and looked at the animals that survived, that were in good condition, and that could reproduce under unfavorable conditions. See, now, this is an animal that is well adapted to these conditions. Let's look at his or her characteristics. We found out that you got to have a fairly long neck. It might be have something to do with the ability to rear its head, to graze easily. And I think it is also when a kid gets born, if you get that very blocky kid, that very muscular developed kid, then you have a difficult birth. And one of the things is in the savannah goat, we also look at that. Animals that have problems in giving birth, we rather eliminate them.
Do you find that that is related to their structure on their rump? Do you have a fairly sloping rump?
Yes, we have a fairly sloping rump with them. And as I say, we try and really try and make things easier for farmers. Farmers in South Africa and all over the world, they've got a lot of problems. And so why start and breed an animal that increase their problems? They, in South Africa, we've also got labor problems. And as I say, environmental conditions are unfavorable. So why breed a, select an animal that is going to give you problems? Rather breed, select for easy care traits.
Is that essentially why some of the traits, faults that have been noticed with Boer goats have essentially come probably from man's decision to say on the head type to look for that really beautiful and impressive looking Roman head. But when we see the recessed nostrils, we see the problems with the jaws, we know that the feet are not as good. Also, some of the mothering ability traits. Do you feel that this is maybe going to limit the role of the boar goat in more commercial, extensive conditions?
Yes, Brian. It is definitely, I think it limits the boar goat's possibilities. And it has almost resulted in the boar goat developing into a male line, because you can still use that animal to produce slaughter animals with those traits. But if you have females with those traits, then you have a lot of problems. Something as basically as simple as hooves. We try and breed the savannah goat, whether it's a white savannah, a roan, or a solid red. We try and breed them with a dark colored hoof, and we discriminate against hooves that grow out that you have to cut, because we say it costs you labor, and you've got to take off for 2 or 3 days to cut those hooves. And in South Africa, in dry conditions, those hooves are very hard. So, and it limits. You have an animal that can't walk easily. So why go for that? In actual fact, we found out that you can select against those faults that you've mentioned, as well as the faults of the nostrils, the upper jaw, the lower jaw. Those are all faults that can be selected against. And we try and, in the savannah goat, and also some of the breeders, make no mistake, even in boar goats, are starting to see the light and discriminate against that. I must admit, personally, at the last national championships here in Bloemfontein, there were some pretty impressive red-headed boar goats, and the winners there were really outstanding. They impressed overseas visitors as well as South Africa. But we know from experience that if you don't watch out, then those outstanding animals may have traits that are not conducive to commercial production of meat. And also in South Africa, a lot of goats are also used for milk production, and they leave a little for the kids, but these indigenous goats, because they their ability to survive under unfavorable conditions, therefore they are used for milk production instead of using the imported silage and things like that. So they not only produce meat, but they also produce milk, and even under certain conditions, they even produce cashmere hair if you prepare to take the trouble to come down.
Yes.
The cashmere hair wasn't bred in intention; it was bred in because they've got to survive under unfavorable temperature. As I said, the temperature and the rainfall and sunlight, those are harsh masters. And if you don't respect them, they don't respect you.
So there is some savannah goats, there is definitely distinctive cashmere ability in some of the goats?
Yes, there is definitely. But we